Well, actually, I've never seen a ghost. I have collected hundreds of ghost stories from all over the South. And I have visited every place I've ever written about or told about. And I've given the ghost every opportunity to make my acquaintance. But none of them have. None of them has. No one of them has. But there's a fascination, I think, about ghosts, because we're really not sure. It's something that we just are not certain about. Nearly everything that we encounter, there's some scientific explanation for it. You can explain nearly everything. But ghosts, do they exist or don't they exist? And that's something you can decide for yourself. And the good ghost stories do not require that you believe in ghosts. I don't care whether you believe in ghosts or not. The good ghost stories are the traditional tales, the stories that have been handed down in families, though many of them are brand new. They're ghost tales. I had a woman this week call me with a new ghost story that had happened to her that she was very upset about. And I managed to calm her down. But whether you believe in them or not, they are a part of our Southern tradition. Not only in the South, but stronger in the South, I think. Because we are storytellers in the South. And we like to tell about ghost stories, especially if we know the people who are involved in them. Now, I say that the ghost stories I write are true. And they are true in that you can visit the place where they happen. The names of the people involved are absolutely accurate. I visited the cemeteries and graveyards where these people are buried and checked out the dates and see that they, if they coincide with the ghostly encounters. And in fact, my 13 Alabama Ghosts and Jeffries used to teach Alabama history in some schools, because it is a history of the state told through ghost stories, some of them. But what got me started in ghost stories, I've always liked them, enjoyed listening to them, but never gave them much importance. I wasn't deeply interested in them. But in 1966, something that we call Jeffrey came to this house in Selma where we live. Whether it's a ghost or not, I can't say, because nobody's ever seen it. But there's definitely a presence in this house. I was alone out in the family room reading one afternoon. It was in October of 1966. Bright, sunny day. And I heard these heavy footsteps clumping down the hall. The door to my son's room opened and slammed. And I thought he had come home from Birmingham Southern. And I called him. He didn't answer. And I called a little louder. He didn't answer. And I got up to see, and there's nobody in the house. It made me feel a little bit strange, but I decided I wouldn't mention it to anybody. But, you know, that she's been pretty good up to now, but something's happened to Mama. But a few days later, my youngest daughter, Dilsey, and I were out there reading, and our cat was sound asleep, an old cat named Hornblower, about 14 years old. And he was asleep on his cushion in the rocking chair. I heard those same steps going down the hall, and I looked at Dilsey to see if she were hearing it too, and her eyes were getting real big. And that old cat waked up out of his sound sleep and jumped down out of that rocking chair, arched his back, and the hair stood up around his neck and his tail got still. He'd yell in it. He couldn't get... excuse me, couldn't get out of that room. He couldn't get out of that room fast enough. It was obviously something had frightened him. But nobody has ever been afraid of Jeffrey. It's been a pleasant thing to have him there. He stirred up my interest in ghost tales. And I went over to Huntington, where I had graduated, and talked to the college folklore teacher over there, Margaret Fye, about Jeffrey. But I went over there to talk to Margaret Fye about Jeffrey. We talked about other famous Alabama ghosts. We decided it was a pity their stories had not all been collected in one book, and we did it. The most famous of them. Some you know are not true. They're just what we call jump tales that make you jump. And obviously are made up. But the ones that need to be preserved are the ones, I like the ones where there's physical evidence of the ghost having been there. And like that face in the courthouse window, thank you, in Carrollton. Mm-hmm. There's no doubt about, I mean, there's that face up there. And there's a wonderful story about that. And the really good ghost stories have some connection with history. They tell us who we were or who our ancestors were. And they tell us a great deal about what life was like at the time when these ghosts were inhabiting the earth or whatever they're doing when they were alive. And they stir our imagination. They make us wonder. A really good ghost story will leave you asking, could that really be true? Do you suppose that really did happen?
Do you think people have a need to believe ghosts?
Yes, I do. It's a release, kind of. There's something that we don't know. We have to admit we don't really know. And it's, we need that. Well, I got very upset with him when I was preparing my income tax. He kept moving papers that I had left right before. I knew exactly where they were, organized, and I could take on down to the accountant, but they disappeared. And there was nobody in the house but me, and I know Jeffrey just moved them, did something bad about it. And he hides things from me. He's very mischievous. I have found my car keys in the refrigerator, which I know I did not put them in the refrigerator. So, just little things like that, but every now and then he does something that really pleases me.